You have a TV?
No. I just like to read the TV guide. Read the TV guide. You don't need a TV.
Hello and welcome to TV Guidance Counselor. I am Ken Reed. I am your TV Guidance Counselor, as always. And I want to welcome you to Wednesday, aka New TV Guidance Counselor Day. I am very excited about today's episode. This is an old friend of mine in that I've known him for a long time, not that he is of an advanced age. My guest this week is Mr. Zach Sherwin, the artist formerly known as MC Mr. Napkins. He is a comedian, writer, comedy rapper, and just an interesting guy. I really like talking to him. I met him in Boston years ago, which we talk about here, trying to actually pinpoint exactly when that was. I don't know if we know if we ever come to an answer. He moved out to LA a long time ago. I always try to see him when I go out there. I always like performing with him. He's got a great show at a really weird old French restaurant on Sunset called Tax. I always like doing that show, and I always try to do it whenever I'm out there. There is quite a lot of drug talk in this episode. I'm a staunch anti-drug person, but we have some real adult talk here. I think you'll like it very much. Zach has a new record out called Rap, appropriately. I haven't confirmed this, but I think there is a record that a song on that record that I inspired called Generally Gin RV. He better have that on there, because otherwise he's in big trouble. So please sit back, relax, and enjoy this week's episode of TV Guidance Counselor with my guest, Zach Sherwin.
Zach Sherwin.
Hi guys. Hi Ken.
It's been a while.
Yeah.
Because, you know, I've come out here, Zach and I go back a while. When did I first meet you? 2006?
We always like to talk about it.
Yeah, we do.
We should figure out when we started.
I don't think we ever definitively figured it out. It has to be like 2006.
Yeah, 2006 was when I started, and we probably met then, but really started knowing each other in 2007. But we should figure out when we started trying to figure out when we met each other.
I think it's about 2008. I think it's about 2008 that we figured that out.
When did we start talking about each other?
Yeah.
Yeah.
It was around then.
Yeah.
But we've been... you were one of the first people I bugged when I started doing this thing, and it's been almost a year since I was able to actually... in the same city at the same place.
Wow.
Time.
Is it a year old?
Yeah. Yeah.
That's great.
Yeah.
I'm touched to be one of the first people you bugged, buddy.
Yeah. Oh, absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Because weirdly, so Zach is a musical comedian, I would say, predominantly, although not exclusively. And I think I've said this to you before. I actually think our material is very similar, but with a completely different execution.
Yeah, our delivery vehicle is couldn't be more different. Although it's weird. Lately, I've been writing, I have not been having ideas for songs nearly as much as I have for stand-up, and it's been really creatively exciting for me.
Right.
But,
because a lot of your songs would be about, like Plush Piggy or, like, the stuff about growing up is, like, I would do that, but as, like, a story.
Yeah.
Instead of as a song, you know?
Yeah.
The prank phone call one is one that always comes to mind.
Oh, the Kentucky Fried Chicken one.
Yeah.
Right.
Also, you're smarter than me.
I certainly don't think that's true. I think we have different kinds of intelligence.
Possibly.
And also some of the same ones. But this is—I haven't thought about it in this framework yet. And I know we have to get to the thing, but
we don't have to get to any. We can do whatever we want.
Maybe the reason I'm writing fewer songs nowadays and more stand-up stuff is because I'm starting to talk more about what I'm like now.
Right.
And the songs that I wrote were more what I used to be like. Things that happened to me.
And there's also a an artifice to the songs. Like, there's a layer that you're putting between your experience and you, and you're probably over that a little bit.
And early on, in what I think of as, like, wave one of my raps, the premise was, who would ever write a rap about this? The topic is so unlikely. So,
like, it's changed a little bit for that, too.
Yeah, that's right. But early on, I had, like, you know, my first song that I did all the time was Sphygmomanometer, about the absurd name for a blood pressure cuff.
Right.
And now I just... You know, the joke is no longer...
Right.
That's no longer interesting.
I think that the hip-hop... It's hard to find things that are incongruous with hip-hop now.
That's right.
And also... inherently...
Yeah. That's totally true. People write stuff about, and like rappers like Lil Wayne have made it very mainstream to incorporate all kinds of random references.
Right.
That's just not even a thing now. Everybody does it.
It's not even, well, I don't want to go that far. I was going to say that hip hop isn't a culture unto itself anymore as much as it's really just been absorbed into
it's the default.
Yeah. It's just been absorbed into mainstream culture. So it would incorporate everything.
I know. Or at least it's as mainstream as the most mainstream things are.
Yeah. Yeah. But if you listen to, like, I mean, I don't even know who pop groups are. Taylor Swift.
Yeah.
Sure, she has hip-hop elements in her songs.
She had her last, you know, I knew Trouble. Did you know that song?
No,
that
big single? I could not name a Taylor Swift song.
Mm. That one made a big splash because it was like a dubstep.
Okay.
There was a dubstep thread to it.
I'm glad I don't know what that is.
You have never heard of dubstep?
I've heard people use the term dubstep, but I've never heard dubstep.
I bet you have, and if I played it and said, this is dubstep, you'd be like, oh, this sounds familiar.
Is it like techno reggaeton?
It's sort of like, it's got a reggae-ish feel to it.
Okay.
It has big drops, like woozy bass. Okay. It's like throbby, kind of.
Okay.
These aren't, I'm sure people who know specific descriptors for it exactly are like screaming at the iPhone right now.
No, but I can tell you exactly what it is. I remember that I was a huge music fan and super into music, and then I still am, but I stopped paying attention to new things around the millennium. So I'm just totally out of touch with whatever's happened in the last 15 years.
It's a bit of a relief.
It kind of is, yeah. It kind of is.
You can never keep up.
No, you absolutely can't. I remember when I lived in Somerville, Mass, which is has a large Hispanic community. I was going to say population, and I almost said popularity. It probably has a large Hispanic popularity as well. Everyone was listening to reggaeton, and I didn't recognize that it was a genre and not the same song.
Oh, wow.
Because it has all the same beat, and I was like, everybody's listening to this song.
Hmm.
Everybody. It's really crazy.
That is interesting. That's like reggae has a thing where like everybody, one record will become a hit, and then it's just the thing of the, it's like the idiom of the genre that everyone raps over that rhythm.
Yeah. Yeah.
So,
cause it's my knowledge and love of like black music is really strong up until like the mid-80s.
Mm.
And that's when all that stuff started getting recycled into hip-hop stuff is when I kind of checked out.
Are you not an early hip-hop guy? I thought you sort of were.
Yeah, I like early hip-hop. The thing about it, I sort of like the idea of it more than the execution and a lot of stuff. And I like the offshoots. So I end up liking stuff like freestyle more and the more dancey stuff. But being an old punk rock kid, the aesthetic of it where punk rock was, we know three chords, that's all we need to know. Mm. And hip hop was, we don't even need to know those three chords. We need to know someone who knew those three chords and we can just use that record.
Mm.
And that, I love that idea because it's sort of the next step in that stuff, which is cool.
Yeah.
But once it started, the gangster rap stuff really turned me off. And although I did like some Ghetto Boys stuff and I did like horrorcore stuff.
I met Willie D on the tour that I was on.
Did you?
That I've been on. Yeah.
How was that?
Not super eventful for me.
Yeah.
Willie D, one of the Ghetto Boys.
Yes.
He was at the show that I've been on tour with W. Kamau Bell, fantastic comedian. I've been like opening for him on this headlining tour he's doing.
Yeah.
We did a show in Houston and Willie D was just there. Big Crit, a rapper, was playing in the big room and we were in the smaller room. And Willie D was just hanging around and he kind of like pounced on Kamau for an interview for like WillieD.tv or whatever
it is.
But I met him for a minute and we said hello. It was pretty uneventful.
Yeah, that's probably the best thing that you could have, meeting a ghetto boy.
Yeah, he was very personable and handshaky.
Well, I think when you realize that so much of the gangster rap stuff was sort of a cartoonish exaggeration, you see these people now.
Yeah, we're just people at backstage.
Who are just sort of, you know, exaggerating that world a bit.
Yeah, that's right.
Which is kind of why the biggest audience for that was white suburban teenagers in the 80s, because it was very exotic.
Were you into the Beastie Boys when they were at that apex of early hip-hop and punk?
No, I like some of their earlier stuff that sounds like Bad Brains, but I didn't like the...
They loved the Bad Brains.
Oh, yeah. That's where they got their name from. The groupies of the Bad Brains people used to refer to as Beastie Girls.
Really?
Because they were ugly, apparently.
Really?
And so they
took
that
name. I did not know that.
They were like, we're like male groupies for Bad Brains. We're the Beastie Boys.
That's so funny.
Yeah.
Wow.
So I like Dubstep, but I always like dancier stuff. And I love, like, Luscious Jackson.
Yeah. And who was on Grand Royal.
Who was on Grand Royal. With Ben Lee and other non...
Yeah.
And Sibo Mato, who are awesome.
Right.
So I like some of that stuff, but...
Didn't the woman from Sibo Mato date Sean Lennon?
Yes, I believe she did.
Who was the son of a Beatle, who the Beastie Boys sampled on Paul's Boutique.
Yes.
It's all the same.
Yeah. That was the thing, too, that got less interesting for me. When people were able to make, like, true sound collages, that was... you know, seconds and notes samples that they built into truly new things, that was interesting. But when the legalities of that were prohibitive and people were like, we're just taking a hook from a song and that's our sample, I was like, this is boring now.
Yeah.
Because you're not making something new.
Right.
And it's not a cover and it's not new, so it's like not one and not the other.
As late as like when Puffy was doing it?
No.
Earlier than that.
Yeah. So if you look at like even the Beastie Boys and like early De La Soul,
yeah,
where you would have a song that might have 50 different samples in it from all kinds of different songs,
yeah,
and that was interesting because you couldn't recognize what it was from,
right?
Because it became something new,
right?
But when Puffy's doing an entire Led Zeppelin song, taking the vocals out and basically just rapping over it, it's not really that interesting to me.
Yeah, I was just listening to Girls Ain't Nothing But Trouble, the Fresh Prince song,
yeah.
And it's just, they're just rapping over the Green Acres.
Yeah, it's a...
Or no, do, Price is Right.
Yeah, no, that's I Dream of Jeannie.
I Dream of Jeannie, yes, thank you.
Yeah, it's like, and weirdly, that was the first bits of it when then people would isolate the breakbeats and stuff.
Yeah.
But just to take the hook, the other thing is I'm more forgiving of an early hip-hop because I'm like, your resources were limited. You just have a turntable. You can't sample. You can't mix. You're not cutting tapes and stuff. You're doing it live. So, okay, take the hook. But now it's, you know, late 80s and you have this access to this stuff. So do something interesting. And people stop doing interesting things to me.
Interesting.
But that's just me.
Yeah. Yeah. All right.
Agree to disagree.
Yeah.
So you picked 1988, a great year of hip hop.
Yeah.
No MTV Raps was really coming into its own.
Sure. The Beastie Boys were out.
Beastie Boys were out. Not gay.
No.
They were putting out music.
No. Yeah. Do you know what their first album title was supposed to be?
We're Gay.
No. It was, I'm going to use the word.
Okay.
Don't Be a Faggot was.
Yeah. That sounds like an album title that they would have.
Because
they were big fans of the sort of offensive punk rock world with guys like Steve Albini, who was doing a band called Big Black, and then did a band called Rape Man.
Oh, really? Do you remember Anal Cunt? That band from Boston? Did you know those guys?
I did, yeah. Seth, who is dead now.
Dead?
He's dead. That guy was a maniac. There was a band from Boston, if people don't know, called Anal Cunt. They went by the name AC. And musically were horrific. Like, I still contend that anyone who says they listen to them is lying. Because what they would do is they would go into the studio and literally just make noise. And then cut it up and put random titles on it. So, like, offensive titles. So they had titles like You're a Faggot and Peppy the Gay Waiter and You Live in Alston, You're Gay. Like, those are the names of their song titles. But live, Seth was really violent. And if you went to that show, you stood far away from the stage because he would just come off the stage and start hitting people with metal things. And there was a lot of blood and it was very, very violent shows.
Wow.
Yeah, I saw them at the Rat several times. It was
the Rat.
Bloody shows.
Wow. How did he die?
I don't 100% know. I think he might have had some sort of drug thing. I think he had a stroke or something at one point. I didn't know him very well, but he definitely was not a healthy guy, and I'm sure had suffered some trauma.
It seemed like there was a lot going on.
Yeah. But some of their titles were very funny, and sort of the joke of that band, like, I think is funny.
Yeah.
But
they seem like they wanted to provoke.
Yeah, it was definitely provocative stuff. You know, hey, sometimes the music doesn't live up to the provocation. So you picked a week that's your birthday week, 1988.
Yeah.
We're the same exact age, 1980?
Yeah.
Oh, we're the same exact age.
Yeah, you're like 3 days older than me.
Yeah, I'm 3 days older than Zach, because when you pulled this out, I realized it's also my birthday week.
Yeah.
Eighth birthday. So let's jump right in. So Saturday night, 8 o'clock, what did you go
with? I went with a nature documentary called Snakes, Eden's Deadly Charmers.
Yes. So this was narrated by Leonard Nimoy.
You just know that?
Yes.
And oh, my God. Are you looking at the description, or do you just know that?
I'm looking at the description, but I knew this was narrated by Leonard Nimoy.
Yeah. Yeah.
So it says, a survival Anglia study of snakes, which are marvelously designed, wonderfully diverse, and whether you like it or not, extremely beautiful.
Yeah.
That's, once again, editorializing from TV.
Is that a through line?
Do you like snakes?
Not particularly, but what I really like is getting high and watching nature documentaries. Okay. I don't really love pot that much. I enjoy drugs. Pot is not anywhere near my favorite drug.
What's your favorite drug?
I've tried, I've done, until recently I would have said magic mushrooms, but I've experimented with ayahuasca and have plans to do it again. Kaplan got to me. And I have plans to do it a third and fourth time. It's pretty great.
So you like the psychedelics?
I like psychedelics. Marijuana, I feel like some people really take to it. I'm enjoying calling it marijuana.
Yes.
Pot feels weird.
Marijuana, weed feels hacky. Sometimes
yeah.
I say, yeah.
That's fun.
Yeah. Jazz cigarettes.
So yeah, it kind of slows me down, and I enjoy having my brain pinging around as much as possible. And even when I smoke the up kind, sativa, I think is the strain that makes you more up-y. Okay. It doesn't really do that for me. So, but I really do like watching BBC documentaries when
because
I'm
your focus is crazy, or you just are like,
I don't know. It's just a nice combination for me.
Are you buying into the sort of Mike Kaplan, mutual friend of ours, who has also been on the show and is a recent convert to ayahuasca? He's very much into the very hippie-ish one love kind of aspect of that and the nature stuff and all that. Is that maybe why you're like the psychedelics and watching nature programs seems to make sense?
Well, it's interesting. I mean, ayahuasca is very snake related. There's a lot of snake stuff going on with it. And a lot of people report seeing like divine snakes when they go in.
Well, there are. So as a complete skeptic and a very... I don't want to say anti-drugs person, but anti-drug mythology person.
Okay.
My understanding of these sort of vision quest type drugs is that what they essentially do is induce a false sense of death in the person. Mm. And when you're about to die, your brain releases certain chemicals.
Right.
And as part of these chemicals, you often see patterns, and several of the patterns of our cells in nature are spirals or snake-like in nature.
Mm-hmm.
So that would make sense. I mean, you...
Yeah. And it's also, you know, I've read that the Caduceus, the healing symbol...
Caduceus ayahuasca?
Yeah.
They're on frat row. They're a bunch of dicks.
Mike and I used to have a joke together that... you know, it's like the stick with two snakes twined around it. And it's like the DNA helix.
Right,
I mean, that's
right.
You know, that's people have made that connection for a long time. His joke that we kind of co-wrote was that it's like the sound of getting hit with a stick and then a snake. Kadoosh.
Yeah.
So, yeah, you know, the two twin spiraling snakes. And so, you know, like the history of the healing plant, that there's some connection there.
Right. With snakes.
I do, but I mean, it was very profound. And Mike says a really wise thing, I think, about it, which he's probably said to you, which is that even if it's not true, quote unquote, the insights and lessons that it imparts, like, are very applicable in a sort of like long-term kind of way and also day-to-day.
Yeah. I mean, I think that kind of what people tend to get out of those sorts of experiences is of a letting go of the small stuff kind of thing. And you would also find that people who've had near-death experiences have very similar experiences where they go, life's too short. You know, we should treat people better. Why am I worried about things that don't matter? Like, ultimately, that's sort of where you're kind of getting at.
I did also see imagery of like what, you know, kind of like the fabric of reality is.
Yeah.
And I know you're skeptical about that, but you should try the drugs and see what it does to your skepticism.
You would not want to see me on any sort of hallucinogenic drug. I have a very thin veneer of sanity.
Oh, really?
Oh, yes.
So then how can you be so resistant to this? You know that if you just pierce that, there's like all this other stuff going on.
Because I, my life is all about suppression and control. And I am the opposite of people who I feel like need a drug to unleash things. I'm constantly holding back a wall of things. And it's... You know, I've had hallucinations without the use of drugs before. If you stay up for a week, you'll have similar experiences.
Oh, yeah. That's kind of a drug, sleeplessness.
Absolutely, yeah. I mean, it's all your brain chemistry. It's what triggers your brain to create this chemistry stuff. And it's not... I don't know. I don't really think that the insights it would give me, I think if anything, it would just make me incredibly violent.
Oh, yeah. That's not good. You don't want to Seth out on anyone.
No, no, absolutely not. I may start a band.
But I mean, I don't, my jury is definitively out. I'm very open to the possibility that there is some.
You're generally a very positive person.
Yeah, I mean, I my jury's still out as to whether or not I'm communicating with something in myself, or if it is actually you're tapping into some spirit world or something. I hope that's true. Collective
unconsciousness and very Jungian sort of.
Yeah, I don't. I haven't read Jung enough to know if that's accurate from what I feel, but like, I don't think that there's like a god that I don't usually talk to that I then get to talk to when I do it. But I think that there's some of that to it, and also like, it's more like. Whatever. It sounds too crazy and druggy in this context.
No, it's good. Well, yeah, TV Guide has led us to the. A lot of people get high and watch nature documentaries. I think that's a common experience you'll find. And, you know, it may be, and people often watch them and are like, whoa, yeah, it's all. It's a big plan kind of thing. Because you tend to see patterns when you're high.
Well, yeah, here's. The last time I did it, I got to do it again with my girlfriend. We love it, and we haven't done it in a long time.
And you do it together.
Yeah, we really have fun doing it together. And so we watched this documentary, and I remember being really stoned. I don't get stoned very often. I was very high.
Right.
And I was watching it, and I was like, this science fiction is crazy. Right. And then I was so stoned that I'd forgotten what we were watching. And then I was like, wait a minute. And I said to her, this is real. And we were like, whoa. I also enjoy the concept of getting to listen to Leonard Nimoy's voice at a time when he was still not just like a cultural nostalgia item.
Yeah, I mean, he was also, he used to host a show called In Search Of. Which, have you ever seen that show?
No, I don't.
It was a bit like Unsolved Mysteries, and would do episodes about things like Vision Quest, Nation of Native American Vision Quest, and in the afterlife and the collective unconsciousness. And that was in the 70s. And he started narrating these shows and then would get sort of more quote unquote legit nature gigs after that.
Yeah.
So, you know, it's, this was what he was doing then. He was more well known for that.
I wish that dude well, you know, I'm glad he was getting these gigs. He's got a cool voice. He looks cool. I feel like he's like a Jew who
he's from Boston. He grew up in Scully Square in Boston, was the really rough part, like basically the Times Square of Boston.
Really?
And he moved to Boston. He moved out of Boston to get away from all that stuff. And
he's so erudite and patrician.
He had a very strong Boston accent for years and couldn't get roles and has a really fascinating story.
No way.
I recommend his autobiography. It's actually very, very good.
Okay. What's it called? I Am Not Spock. Did we have something called that?
That's what it's called. I'm not Spock.
On the new Wu-Tang album, Method Man rhymes, you know, B-Boy and Decoy with Leonard Nimoy. It was nice to hear him get a shout.
That makes sense.
He's talking about how, you know, he's buds with Redman.
Yeah.
Redman calls himself the Funk Dr. Spot.
There is sort of a very odd connection between hip-hop and sci-fi. There always has been. And I think it probably comes out of the funk stuff.
He might be... Sorry, I'm getting my hip-hop trivia. I feel like there was a little confusion for a while as to whether or not Redman was Funk Dr. Spock or Funk Dr. Spot.
Was that confusion with Redman himself?
Yeah, he himself gave out more than one. He's like an unreliable narrator about that. But Method Man says something like, you know, the Funk Dr. Spock, and that's not Leonard Nimoy.
It's weird because you don't see a lot of black people into... Well, you see more of it now, but in the 80s and 90s, you would never... Like, I went to a lot of comic conventions and a lot of sci-fi things, and it was white as white could be.
Yeah.
There was not even, like, Italians there. It was that white. But from the very origins of hip-hop, Afrika Bambaataa, P-Funk, it's really out there sci-fi stuff.
Yeah, that's right.
It kind of always has been. It never really went away. There's always been that element,
or less. You could also point to stuff like the Outkast album, ATLians. Lil Wayne has an album called I Am Not a Human Being.
Right. It's a very weird, and I wonder if part of that is related to the nature of the instrumentation of those things, and the fact that hip hop exists is because of technology. It's not an acoustic. It's not an acoustic form of music.
Okay,
I've seen people do it that way, but it's inherently not.
Yeah, I mean, for sure. Planet Rock, yeah. Afrika Bambaataa from the beginning, that stuff.
Yeah.
I was going to say, I think a rapper, have we talked about MF Doom or Dino stuff?
Yes, yeah.
He has just, I feel like you would love him if only for the references. Like, it just would be fun to hear his encyclopedic reference base matched up against yours.
Yeah, I mean, the one thing, people have said that to me a bunch about a lot of the reference hip-hop things. Mm-hmm. And the thing that it doesn't appeal to me about it is that it's almost like reference comics, where if you're not doing anything with the reference, if you're just saying, here's a string of references, isn't that cool? I like people who are like, here's the reference, but here's the content, my personal context of it.
Can I offer you up a for instance?
Yes.
Okay, MF Doom on a song of his called Ho Cakes, which I would argue is one of his better known songs in his weird body of work.
Okay.
He says, I'm trying to think of all the things that rhymes with, but he goes, one pack of cookies, please, Mr. Hooper.
Yes.
It's fun smacking rookies. He is the, and then the sample throughout the whole song goes, Supa. It's from JJ Fadd's song, Supa.
Right, right.
So he goes, one pack of cookies, please, Mr. Hooper. It's fun smacking rookies. He is the Supa. Looks like a black Wookiee when he lets his beard grow. So I like pack of cookies, smacking rookies with black Wookiee.
Right.
But also, it's nice that there's a Sesame Street and a Star Wars reference and a J.J. Fadd sample in the space of that.
And I love J.J. Fadd.
Yeah.
See, I like J.J. Fadd, but then I would get, I'm probably a little more mature now, but when I would hear a hip-hop sample sampling another hip-hop song, I'd be like, just do something interesting. You know what I mean? Like, because at least when people were taking stuff from other genres, I could be like, the context is totally different.
Right.
But when and I've noticed that in the last few years, they're sampling other hip-hop songs.
Oh, yeah.
And then sometimes sampling samples.
Yeah.
They may not even know they were samples.
Right.
Which to me is just like,
Yeah. It is interesting that that's happening, that hip-hop's eating itself, to take it back to the snake, like right. The head is eating the tail. Like, wow. I didn't even mean for it to be this, but yes. The Nicki Minaj song Anaconda,
yep.
More Snakes,
yep.
Is a Sir Mix-a-Lot.
Yeah.
And I just learned that she's 5'3", and there's that, you know, that iconic lyric in the song, only if she's 5'3". I wonder if that had anything to do with the decision. Or if it's just about big butts and being 5'3".
It's probably just about big butts and being 5'3".
Yeah, but it's a nice, well, I mean, I wonder if the 5'3", it's obviously just about big butts, but I wonder if the 5'3" was a
sometimes things are just about big butts.
I think Freud
said that. Everybody, you do ayahuasca and you're like, what happened? It's all about big butts, man. That's what the world told me. It's all about big butts. That's it. If you know a friend who did that and came out of it that way, I bet you'd have a lot more difficult time not being skeptical. As tolerant as you tried to be, they were like, it's big butts is everything.
I'll say two things. One, the insights are too replicated and replicable for it to be something like that. But it's got a real sense of humor, that drug, and I would not put it past it to be like, and also, big butts are like it, and you're like, oh my god, I didn't even realize it.
But if you look to it, like, not to get too serious here, but if you look at some other things that are very replicable and very consistent, the hallucinogen-wise. So the example I would use is people who believe they have had alien abductions.
Right.
That is related to a very specific part of your brain that controls sleep paralysis. And when that part of the brain is not working right, it makes these people have almost identical experiences without having, and this is before that stuff was prevalent and people may have seen it somewhere else. So there are certainly, as far as collective unconscious goes, there are certainly things in people's brains that are similar because we're the same machine.
Yeah.
And so in that respect, yeah, it'll tap into those things. But, you know, I don't know if we're all one.
Here's the bet I'm willing to take, right? Those drugs are fascinating. The insights that they give me do help me be a better a person that I'm happier being in a day-to-day kind of way.
Right.
I also am willing to at least entertain, because of the vividness with which I've seen some things, that I might have gotten an insight into some ancient wisdom about what happens after we die.
Right.
And therefore, what to reverse engineer what life should be spent like.
Right.
and it's soothing and reassuring as opposed to terrifying.
Right.
So I just feel like it's like Pascal's wager, but in a much more meaningful way.
Yeah.
You know, I'm like, this is going to be great while I'm alive, and it's going to make me less afraid to die. If, you know, one thing that I've thought is, if I ever do get diagnosed with like a, you've got 6 months to live, like as soon as I can, I'm going to get myself to a...
That's what Zach calls owing someone money. I just got diagnosed with a, you got 6 months to live.
As quickly as I can, I'm going to get myself to like a reputable shaman and like drink some ayahuasca to like see what to do with the information.
Yeah. But,
so like, it'll make me less afraid. And then if I die... Maybe it will just be eternal nothingness, which is what I assume.
But you've
what
been
you
less
believe.
Afraid before.
I've been less afraid, and if it's right, oh my God, I hope, Ken, I hope with all my heart that the thing that I saw is real and that I will have some instant millisecond between being me and then, like, being dead where I get to be like, oh, it was right.
Right. I mean, but you've just described all religions there. That's kind of the basis of, well, before they get political and powers.
That's right.
But at their core, that's what all religions do. It's supposed to keep you, alleviate fear and give you hope.
The only difference between, I was raised Jewish and have a very positive relationship to it culturally, and the religious stuff of it has been more and less meaningful to me my whole life, but never in like a... doing the hallucinogenics that I've done has opened it up in a much more convincing way that makes sense to me.
Right.
It's like, you know, you don't know the meaning of a word until you've, like, experienced the reality of it.
Right.
And then when you use it, it has more meaning for you. So
I do... I eat cake all the time.
Sorry, comedy podcast. Yeah.
No. I get that. I certainly get that. And I think that I'm inherently wired skeptically. Some people, I think your brain is just wired that way.
It must be.
Yeah. And I'm very, very, very tactile. Like,
and also, I mean, it's probably somewhat how you're born and also how you were brought up, right?
Sort of. I mean, my parents were raised Catholic. I grew up in Boston Catholic, very religious. Everyone I knew went to Sunday school and got communion. And literally, I don't remember a time when I ever believed that. As a little kid, I legitimately, people would be like, here's the thing. And I was like, well, I don't think so.
Don't you think you could be so negatively influenced by that experience that you would be indisposed towards religion for the rest of your life?
Not necessarily. I don't think it was like the case where someone who's like a victim of sexual abuse becomes like hypersexual or asexual. Like it was like, you know, it wasn't that, because I definitely, it was there if I wanted to participate. But it definitely wasn't thrust on me. Hmm. And it would have been easier for me, certainly, if I had been all about going to church and doing Sunday school and CCD with kids and stuff, because it was a social thing. But I definitely was just like, it doesn't make sense. Hmm. But I also have, you know, a very anti-authoritarian issues and an inflated sense of justice that counteracts a lot of religious things that was, you know, and a lot of that's probably hardwired. That's certainly not from my parents. Hmm. In either a reaction against something from them or as an influence. I have no idea what my dysfunction is.
Well, you're too smart and have thought about this too much for me to argue these points with you. So I'll just say, all right.
We'll agree to disagree.
Yeah.
Yeah. But fair enough. No, I don't
disagree with anything that you're saying about yourself. Right. I'm just saying...
There's more.
I wish I could force feed you in a non-traumatic way. Like, I wish somehow you could drink it, because I would be so... I understand that you never will.
Right.
But I'd be so interested to hear what you would say coming out of it.
What demons I conjured?
Maybe.
I would bring things back with me, Zach, like the movie Flatliners or Nightmare on Elm Street. Like, monsters would come back with me.
I read the movie novelization of Flatliners when I was, like... 8 or something? How old would I have been?
It came out in 91.
Okay, so 11 or 12. Yeah. And there was some real sexual stuff in
there? Oh, yeah. That's not in the movie.
Oh, you read it too?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Whichever Baldwin's character. Wasn't there a Baldwin in it?
Yeah. Stephen Baldwin? I forget what
he was. He was like a Lothario.
Yeah.
And brought
up his videotape screwing ladies.
Oh,
yeah.
That's right.
Yeah.
And they all came back.
Yeah. Because what you would get, there was it Troll Book Club or Scholastic that you got it from through school?
I can't imagine.
It was one
of those.
That's
way too adult.
Well, we would get those from those, though, because...
Really?
The weird thing about movie novelizations is that they would have to come out when the movie came out. And to do that, you have to write it based off the script. And many, many times the movie and the script change a lot or things get cut, which I realized very early on.
That's amazing.
And I would always get novelizations because there would be all kinds of stuff that got cut out of the movie. In the days before DVD, when you could look at deleted
scenes.
That's
amazing.
That's how you found deleted scenes.
Wow, I never knew that.
Yeah, it's kind of fascinating now when you do that, like the novelization of Goonies.
Wow.
I think Kaplan had a bit about this, and I had...
He has a story about it.
About the Dracula thing, right?
I don't know. Go ahead.
But I just... This is true as well. There's a novelization of Bram Stoker's Dracula. Bram Stoker's Dracula is a book. It's a legit book that they made a movie out of. And they did a novelization that's based on the movie. Based on the movie script, not based on the book. So you can get Dracula written by Bram Stoker and Bram Stoker's Dracula the novelization.
That's hilarious.
And there was a few things like that that make no sense.
You should ask Kaplan for his story. That's really funny. And you should ask Mike about his story about RoboCop. He read the book, right, and then everybody had seen the movie, and then he went to school and like jumped in on a conversation.
Oh, yes, and it was a deleted scene.
And everyone was like, "That what?
Yeah,
what
are you talking about? That's not in the movie."
That's the like young Mike-ist story.
Yes.
That kind of story imaginable.
Like, I've read the book of RoboCop.
Oblivious, bullied kid.
Yes, oh, yes, trying to belong. Poor Mike. So, you're from 8 to 9 with the Nature documentary.
For sure.
It's 88, it's Saturday night, it's the last season of Facts of Life. I'm certainly watching that because I knew it had been canceled, and it's in reruns because it's summer, but I'm getting in every single last second of Facts of Life I can get at this point, especially this episode because Pippa is in it, played by Australian Sherrie Krenn, who I had a huge crush on.
Okay.
And this episode, a sponsor of a musical benefit invites Joe and Blair to visit the beauty spa where they are transformed, but not in the way they expect. This is a wacky episode. Blair gets green hair. Pippa starts a band. It's fun. And at 8:30, I'm going with Boys Will Be Boys, which was a summer replacement series. They used to burn off unsold shows in the summer because they, instead of not airing them like they would now, so you would see all these shows that you knew weren't coming back and didn't get
interesting.
Bought. And Boys Would Be Boys is one of those. And this is Matthew Perry.
Wow.
Is in a show. And it was not great, but this is Chaz, played by Matthew Perry. Tells his mother he's going to a religious retreat and then joins Booch and Eugene on a trip to Las Vegas.
Booch?
Booch.
How do you spell that?
B-O-O-C-H.
Oh, Booch.
Like Bach, Ernie Bach Jr. But Booch.
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 Wow.
Something that.
Matthew Perry is the Chaz-iest guy.
He's a super Chaz.
He's a real Chaz.
Also from Massachusetts. From Newton.
Really?
Yeah. So is Matthew, the other Matthew from Friends. Matthew Perry and Matthew... The one is Joey.
Matt LeBlanc.
Matt LeBlanc. Yeah, he's also from Massachusetts.
The Matthew Math.
The Matthew Math. Matthew.
The Matthew Math.
Hey, Matthew! So 9 o'clock, what are you going with?
9 o'clock, I'm going with Eye of the Tiger.
Eye of the Tiger. This is a movie. I am not familiar with this movie.
It looked all right, and it was on Showtime or something.
It's on
and
Cinemax.
It had nudity.
It says it's a crime drama. It only gives it one star. Let's flip to the back of the convenient TV Guide movie reviews where they have in the back of every issue of TV Guide. Now, I will mention I'm much slower than I normally am because when Zach got here, I was... making myself tea in the microwave because the house I'm renting does not have a kettle. And don't ever do that because you will overboil the water and it will explode on you.
Oh, you got a blister, man.
It's a blister. But it's not the gnarliest blister I've ever seen.
No, it's okay. You'll be all right. But your hand's going to be weird for a while.
Yeah. As long as it doesn't hurt. Now there goes my hand modeling career.
I will say... go ahead. You're almost there.
So this is Eye of the Tiger.
Yeah.
Did you read this description?
Yeah, I did.
So it does star Yaphet Kotto.
Yeah.
Who I like and I am Facebook friends with.
Oh.
This is violent, strong language. A Vietnam vet played by Gary Busey goes after the lawman who framed him and the bikers who killed his wife. This is like every action rape revenge cliche of the 70s in an 80s movie.
Yeah.
I'm assuming this is a Canon Group film. I don't know it. Golan and Globus. Two Israelis who made all the bad action movies in the 80s.
Oh, really?
They produced Masters of the Universe, but pretty much every Chuck Norris movie as well.
Hmm.
Yeah.
Israelis and 80s.
Yep.
I think Beck might have rhymed that, but if not, I'm going to plant my flag.
They did create much of the culture we got in the 80s was created by Israelis.
Huh. I know Mighty Morphin Power Rangers was an Israeli product.
Saban. Yes.
I will just say a close second was In Search of the Bowhead Whale, but I didn't want to do too many nature documentaries.
You
and
didn't
that one
want to be high
or boring.
That sounds very boring.
Even the description was boring. It was like, a quest ensues or something.
To find a bowhead whale.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm going with Golden Girls. Certainly Golden Girls.
Okay.
There's no question about it. And amen. That's what I'm doing.
Okay.
A 1973 expedition during the spring thaw. Yeah. Is the description.
They don't even talk about whales.
I believe this was, it was on A&E, and I think it was a rerun of Jacques Cousteau, Jacques Cousteau episode.
Okay. But I'd like to see Jacques Cousteau, but
it's fun sometimes.
At that point, I'm going to want to switch it up, and, you know, the action film feels like an exciting...
That's a good way to end the night.
Yeah.
Yeah. Bikers, I mean, can't go wrong.
Yeah, and I'm not going to want to watch more than an hour of that shit.
No, no, absolutely not.
Yeah, that's enough.
Sunday night, 8 o'clock, what are you going with?
Okay, no brainer. I lit up like a Christmas tree when I saw this. Police Squad.
Yes.
On TV?
Yeah. Yeah. It was very short-lived.
I know. There's like six episodes, right?
There's six episodes. And it was over by this time. It started in 82 or 83.
Okay.
It was only six episodes. But A&E, back when A&E was the Arts and Entertainment Network, used to air a lot of these short-lived series and would air a lot of great stuff like Police Squad and James at 15 and all this kind of stuff. So yeah, Police Squad is absolutely a good movie on Sunday night.
You just cleared up a Beastie Boys reference for me.
James at 15?
Yeah. They have a line where... Ad-Rock goes, I'm not James at 15 or Chachi in charge. I'm Adam, and I'm Adam, and about living large.
Yeah.
That's on Hey Ladies.
Yeah, well, James at 15 was filmed in Boston.
It
was
it's a TV show.
It's a TV show. It's a coming-of-age TV show, yes.
Oh.
And is Ad-Rock Adam Horowitz?
Yeah.
His dad's from Wakefield, Mass.
Right.
Yeah, so he often makes Massachusetts references in Beastie Boys songs.
Wow, what are some others?
They reference Woodman's of Essex, the fried clam place.
In what song?
I don't know.
Wow.
But there's a lot. I'm not the biggest, but he often on his parts of songs there will be many, many references to Massachusetts things.
Interesting.
But I don't think he grew up there. He spent time there, apparently. But his dad written like tens of plays about Wakefield. So you're watching that. I am watching, believe it or not, Skateboarding.
That's what I watch at 8:30.
Yeah, I'm watching that from 8 to 9. And that is the 1987 National Championships taped in Anaheim. I was kind of obsessed with, like, surf culture, skateboarding, all that West Coast stuff that we did not have in the middle of Boston.
That sounds awesome. Yeah. I wish I could watch it right now. I guess I would that's watch what it we're right saying. Now.
Absolutely. And also, the best part of it is at 9 o'clock, I don't know what you went with at 9, but they paired it on the same channel with Swimsuit 87.
Okay, can I talk about my 9 o'clock slot?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
This was the one where I had the toughest time. There was so much I wanted to watch. I would have watched Gary Shandling.
Right, this was It's Gary Shandling show, his Fox show. That was very, very fourth wall breaking. Really cool show.
Yep.
And Vanna White's in this episode, by the way.
Wow. I was interested in the 40th anniversary of Atlantic Records.
That would be interesting.
Yeah. Yeah, see absolutely. Some weird people doing performances. Yeah. I would have checked in with Lethal Weapon just because, you know. Yeah, just to see. And I also would want to watch George Foreman box. That was also happening.
Although this was not his his heyday, really. This was just before we started grilling.
I mean, I'm going to say Shandling and Swimsuit 87 would have been top tier. Atlantic Records and Lethal Weapon tier two. And I would have touched base with Foreman, but...
No, I will also say this, that there's also a special on A&E called Goldie and Liza Together, which is Goldie Hawn and Liza Minnelli. From 1980.
Doing show tunes?
Doing a concert. Yeah, doing show tunes. But Swimsuit 80, I will say, so I was 8 years old. I wasn't 8 years old yet. I was 7 and almost 8, June 26th. But Swimsuit 80, I would have watched in a completely non-sexual way. Like, I would have just been fascinated by the, like, beach surf culture of Swimsuit.
The exotic.
Loved it. Loved beach movies. I went and saw a movie this very year, this very week, actually, called Hunk. That was about a guy who makes a deal with the devil to become like a California surfer.
Oh, wow.
That's a very, very good movie. Loved it. Yeah.
So what a fascinating impulse that speaks to. Like, I would give up who I am and become a hunk.
Yeah. Yeah.
That must have been a desire that people identified with.
He goes back to being the nerdy self that he was.
What?
I don't want to ruin the ending. I don't want to ruin the ending of Hunk.
Wow. Real? Who saw that coming?
Yeah. So you're watching that for the whole hour.
Yeah.
And that's the whole night. That's Sunday.
That's Sunday.
Monday night, 8 o'clock, what are you going with?
Fast Times at Ridgemont High is on.
The movie, not the series.
Correct.
The series, I will mention, I've mentioned it many, many times on the show, is one of my favorite TV shows of the 80s.
Really?
Better than the movie.
Was Sean Penn?
Sean Penn was not in it. The only reoccurring actors were people who played the teachers. So Mr. Hand was in it. Vincent Cervelli was in it. So those were the people who came back. It was all recast, everybody else. But behind the scenes was a lot of the same people. So Penelope, Amy Heckerling, rather, was a producer and wrote a lot of the episodes, directed a lot of the episodes. Cameron Crowe wrote on it. Mm. And it was sort of like a proto Freaks and Geeks. It was a really good show.
Did you, like, what is your personal and professional relationship to Taylor Negron?
I really enjoyed Taylor Negron's stuff. I had never met him before, which is when he died, I was surprised the breadth of people that had interactions with him. And he was in so many things that I loved growing up.
He was in a lot of things.
Enjoyed his stand-up. But yeah, he is in Fast Times. He's in all of Savage Steve Holland's movies, which I loved, which was One Crazy Summer, which is a very important movie for me, filmed in Massachusetts with Tony V. And he was also in Better Off Dead and in all these movies. And Nothing But Trouble, which was, I may have been the only person who liked that movie. Dan Aykroyd's writing, directing debut.
Wow.
One of one.
Huh.
Really weird movie.
All right.
Yeah, how about yourself?
I did Uncabaret with him twice.
Yeah.
And he was always really funny and really nice.
Yeah.
I didn't know him, like, we wouldn't have known each other, but he was really nice.
Yeah, so he is in Fast Times as the pizza delivery man.
And I would also have been interested in whatever Tales of the Gold Monkey was.
Yes, so Tales of Gold Monkey was yet another short-lived series that A&E is rerunning.
One of those summer ones.
It was a summer one. But no, this was a rerunning.
Okay.
This is an early 80s series. It lasted one season. And it was greenlit in the wake of Indiana Jones. So Indiana Jones was huge, if you may or may not remember.
Sure.
And in the wake of that, there was a lot of ripoffs from gum commercials to King Solomon's Mines and just all these ripoff movies. And they greenlit this thing called Tales of Gold Monkey, thinking it would be a ripoff of Indiana Jones, because it's set in the 40s. It's about a pilot. He's got a dog with him. He's an adventurer. And it's much, much, much more like the original serials that inspired Indiana Jones.
Mm.
And it's very, very good. It's a very good show. It's recently sort of got some resurgence of people liking it, but it's a really cool show. I highly would recommend it.
Cool.
Monday nights, although I love Fast Times at Ridgemont High, I will say that my Monday nights belonged to CBS on Monday nights, the Old People Network. And this night, the 8 o'clock shows have been moved back an hour because they're debuting a lame, like some kind of drama that clearly didn't get picked up. So I probably would have watched the first hour of Fast Times at Ridgemont High and then flipped into NBC for the Hogan Family at 8:30, even though it was after Sandy Duncan had replaced Valerie Harper, which was a travesty.
Okay.
But 9 o'clock, I'm absolutely going for Newhart.
I also will just touch that I would have checked in with Mr. Ed at 8:30 on Monday. I used to like that show when I was a kid.
Yeah, Nick at Night used to air that endlessly.
Yeah.
Endlessly. And it was a weird show.
I can't believe I liked it in retrospect. What I remember about it, I'm like, I don't like that. But I did really like it when I was a kid.
It's not a smart show. It's certainly not a smart show. It's a dumb show, but is fun for kids. I could see kids liking
that. I think I just liked that there was a horse that talked. It's like, here's what it was. So much grown-up TV was confusing, and I didn't understand what was happening. And Ed, I felt like the jokes were very horse-based, and it was easy to...
Oh, yes. Yeah, there was no subtext with Ed.
Yeah. 9 o'clock, I'm on Newhart, and also the end of the... Now, this is me being honest to my experience of checking out the guide. Yeah. I only saw that Richard Pryor was on, only at this time slot. So I might have watched him earlier.
Yeah, and that's a special. That's one of his later specials.
I'd have watched the last half hour.
Not his best, but yeah. If there was nothing else on, you could probably find a stand-up special somewhere on cable.
Yeah.
Did you grow up with cable?
No.
Did you?
I grew up with no TV.
Not even in the house?
No TV in the house. Not until I graduated from high school. I've never owned a TV.
You still don't know?
Correct.
So did you watch anything at friends' houses?
Yeah, it was like when I got to friends' houses, it was like kind of a problem because all I wanted to do was watch TV.
And did people treat you like a freak?
I felt sometimes I would feel not in the loop of conversations that were happening.
Right. And did your parents like actively?
It was just my mom, and she like just wasn't into TV. We had a really bitter fight once when I was like 7 or 8.
Right.
And I was like, you're making me different than everybody else.
Right.
And I hate it.
Yeah, you're isolating me from the world.
We're not going to get a TV. Or I think we had one and we plugged it in, but it didn't get anything, you know.
Weird.
Yeah.
So you must have just gone nuts and binged, like, when you went to college or something, right?
I kind of just skipped it. Like, I've binged on Netflix series, but, like, I mean, not that much.
Do you feel disjointed from, sort of popular culture from
your youth? Nah, I mean, I saw, you know, like, people have more Simpsons and Seinfeld references than I do, right. But I get it.
Did you go to the movies, or?
Yeah.
Okay.
Like, a normal amount.
Yeah.
Okay. It wasn't like I was Amish and had to be sheltered from the media or
did
something.
Did you live in a crate under a bed?
Yeah.
But did you, like, listen to the radio and you, yeah, I mean, because kids, I think, are wired to consume as much of the world as possible.
Oh, yeah.
Which is why you get kids who just stay up all night watching TV, stay up all night right. listening to the radio, and just absorb that stuff.
I think that's right. And I got as much music as I could get my hands okay. on. So I listened okay. to a lot of hip-hop.
Okay.
Yeah.
Where did the hip-hop come from?
I was over at my friend Joel Casper's and, I saw the OPP video.
Okay.
And I remember I was like, oh my God. Right. It like, you know, that was my thing that
with
like
the machetes.
Opened me up. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, cause I was going to say almost nobody I know, especially white kids my age, would have listened to hip hop if not for MTV.
Mm-hmm.
Because even radio, you would have had to have known the vaguely underground urban stations in your town
right.
to get on board with it. Otherwise, you're, you know, it's like MC Hammer that you might have heard.
Yeah, yeah. yeah, I'm sure I'd heard Young MC, MC Hammer, and Vanilla Ice.
Right.
But then when I heard Naughty, I was like, oh,
it's very
wow.
different, yeah.
And then, so I heard that, and then at the same time, I was listening to the radio a lot, and I heard Now That We Found Love by Heavy D and the Boys.
Yeah, which is a good song.
And so it's a really good song. Heavy D was a really great, he was like a yeah. terrific rapper.
Yeah.
This is crucial. I asked my Uncle Alan, he asked what I wanted for Hanukkah that year, and I said I wanted the singles of OPP and Now That We Found Love.
Yeah.
But instead he bought me the whole albums of each. And so not only was I able to hear all the ways that it extended in all the directions,
right.
but I also had the cassettes with the liner notes. Right. And so I read like, oh, Heavy D mentions Naughty by Nature. They know about each right. other. That means all these other names.
You discovered a whole world.
Yeah. So yeah. I would just like scrutinize those.
Yeah.
It's not a unique experience. I mean, no, everybody has this, but it was so exciting.
I think the Rosetta Stone nature of liner notes
Rosetta Stone.
Is,
yes, perfect.
Is totally downplayed or not understood by people now because that's how you would, when you're not in New York and you're not in LA and you're growing up in a B town or a smaller town, that's how you hear about these things before the internet. You
go, right.
This is a thing I like.
An algorithm.
What are things that they know?
Yeah. It was like we were making our own Pandoras.
Yeah. Exactly.
Right.
Exactly. And you'd go to the store and sometimes you'd be disappointed.
Yeah. That's
so,
right.
So, fair enough. I'm watching 9:30, absolutely watching Designing Women. This is the groundbreaking AIDS episode repeating.
Oh.
Very, very good episode. Probably wow. the most respectful but humorous and great handling of AIDS.
Who got AIDS?
A friend of theirs.
Oh.
He was a character in the show. He was a gay guy.
Okay.
And died by the end of the episode.
Whoa.
He was kind of reintroduced into the show and was dead.
Did he show up in like the advanced stages of the disease?
Yes, yes, okay. yes, yes. So this is news that a friend is dying of AIDS, has Mary Jo fired up at a PTA debate over sex education, has Julia in a rage over
wow.
a client's narrow viewpoint.
Yeah, it that's pretty
very progressive
pretty
show.
Progressive.
That show was great. It was really, really good.
I've never seen an episode of
it's
it.
It's very well written, and the stuff that they talked about on a national network TV show in 1988 was amazing.
Wow.
Amazing. And not in a sort of cheesy, very special episode way. They often avoided that because it was a smart show.
Who was in it? Delta Burke?
Delta Burke was in it, who's great, who's like a more attractive Katy Perry.
Hmm.
At that time.
Hmm.
And you have Annie Potts, and she's
oh, yeah.
a really great ensemble cast.
Do you know Steve Agee's joke about Annie Potts?
No.
I'm not going to do it justice, so
okay.
if you've heard the real version listeners, or you are Steve listeners,
yeah.
Apologies. It's a story about him and his friend being really stoned, and they're trying to remember the name of the actress who played Janine in Ghostbusters,
mm-hmm.
and they can't do it. And then Steve's friend is like, fuck it. Like, whatever, I'm done thinking about this. I'm going to go make some macaroni and cheese. And he goes into the kitchen, and Steve's just sitting there. And his friend calls out from the other room, do you have any pots? And Steve's like, oh, my God, that's it. And then the
yeah.
joke is about how annoyed God must have been listening to their conversation and being like, how can I get these stoner
yeah.
idiots to get the answer to this?
Yeah, again, you could take drugs until you realize the secret is any pots. And that explains why you didn't want to call it pot, and we're calling it marijuana. So I'm watching that, absolutely. And I want to point out at 10 o'clock, Morton Downey Jr. was on, which
oh.
was a huge phenomenon at the
yeah.
time that you missed out on. That was crazy.
What was it?
He was a real... There's a great documentary about him, but he was a... His dad was a singer in the 50s, and he could not sing. And so he...
What was his dad name?
Morton Downey Jr. 1. Morton Downey Jr. the 1st. And so he discovered, he was sort of a prototypical version of like Glenn Beck. He discovered that you could incite people and get huge ratings. And so he sort of developed this asshole right-wing character, even though he didn't believe any of that stuff. And he would have people on and just get in their face and yell at them, blow cigarette smoke in their face and be outrageous, and it was all a lie. But he became the biggest star in America for about a year because people couldn't believe this show. And then his fame started to fade, and he actually faked being assaulted in a bathroom by neo-Nazis who carved a swastika into his head that he had done himself. He did it himself.
What? Oh, he and went nuts.
Well, sort of.
He carved a swastika into his forehead?
He and claimed that someone did it to him, but it was clear he did it to himself because it was backwards. And then he admitted later that it was a stunt that he did to get attention. So he's a nut.
Does he have a permanent swastika scar?
He did. He's dead now. He died of lung cancer.
Oh, my God.
But it's a really fascinating documentary on him, actually, about Morton Downey Jr. If you're ever bored, I highly recommend. It's a great example of sort of the fame thing, but also it shows you how, instead of learning lessons from him, America, and especially the political entertainment system, has instead just created a whole system in that image. Instead of going, don't let this happen again, they've gone, only let this happen.
Wow.
It's very weird.
Interesting.
Tuesday night, 8 o'clock.
At 9:30 on Monday, I would have watched the first half hour of Color of Money.
Oh, yes. The sequel to what's the movie that's the sequel to? It's Paul Newman and Tom Cruise, but it's a sequel to The Hustler.
The Hustler.
Yes, which was one of the first times that people did a sequel to a movie that was like 20 years old.
Oh.
Very, very weird.
Oh, cool.
Yeah. And it had a really bad theme song that was like a dad blues song. What was it? The Color of Money? It was Eric Clapton.
Oh.
Yeah.
I don't love Eric Clapton.
No, I'm not a fan.
I don't care about it.
He gets almost never sampled, you notice.
Huh.
For such a big artist has a lot of hooks and guitar riffs, you would think he would be sampled.
Do you think it's because he's soulless?
I think it's because he's soulless is where I'm going with it.
I dated a girl who always said that she could instantly diagnose whether or not a musician had soul. It was a grandiose claim, but I liked it.
I think most people could do that.
Yeah.
It's pretty easy to tell. Lenny Kravitz, no soul.
But she said even the people who were like tricky, she had like a compass for it.
Who's the one that surprised you the most that she said? Oh, you were like, no. God. And then you go, oh, you're right.
God, what is it? I can't. I don't know.
You just don't want to burn any bridges. I understand. You're afraid. You're afraid of the soulless contingent. Tuesday, 8 o'clock.
I'm fascinated by whatever the Maurice Sendak hour was.
The Maurice Sendak hour. So did you used to read Maurice Sendak's
books? Yes, I love Maurice Sendak.
So I am sort of into Maurice Sendak, but this is just a biography. This is an A&E again.
Oh, no.
This is a portrait, a 1985 portrait of the author-illustrator.
I guess now that I know that, I wouldn't be the most bored, but I thought it was like a whimsical, absurd, animated surreal things. Show that he hosted or something.
No, no, it's just a portrait. But again, it's clear that A&E would have been your network.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's a lot to handle.
Yeah. So that would have been interesting, but I would have gone with Who's the Boss, a show that I hated but watched every week. Still can't explain it, aside from maybe it was Alyssa Milano related, I don't really know. And this was a repeat of the episode where the spinoff of the model series they had about the show, where they had Leah Remini be an old friend of Samantha's, and then they spun off a show about teenage models, Holly Berry, her first role.
Wow.
Which I loved. It's called Living Dolls, because I was oddly obsessed with the world of modeling at that time.
Okay. You had a lot going on.
I had a lot going on. And at the same time, no.
A rich inner life.
Rich inner life. You could call it that. So I would have watched that. 8:30, you're not watching anything because you're watching Maurice Sendak still?
Yeah, I'm still tuning into Sendak, I guess.
I would have gone with Perfect Strangers, yet another show. Wasn't that into, but watched every week.
I don't have a good taste in my mouth when I hearken back to that show.
It's very slapsticky. I mean, it's very... But at the same time, I totally get why it really appealed to children. I mean, it's a huge slapstick, physical, big, big, big show.
Would Belky undergo mishaps all the time?
That show just should have been called Mishaps.
Wow.
Or maybe more accurately, Dumb Foreigner Mishaps.
It would be like the fish out of water
ignorance would land him in some pickle or other. Yeah.
Well, it was usually his cousin who was a sort of Machiavellian, inflated ego. His own plans would go awry.
Really?
His lies would fold upon themselves. He was sort of a Larry David type character.
His name was Larry.
His name was Larry. Cousin Larry Appleton.
Cousin Larry. I didn't know that he was like that.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And he's great at being insane.
What's that actor's name?
His name is... Oh my God, I know it.
Annie Potts.
It's Annie Potts. Cousin Larry Appleton's name. He does a lot of stage work. I'm blanking. I'm blanking.
Okay.
But I'll come up with it later.
Okay.
So 9 o'clock, what'd you go with?
Weekend in Havana.
Weekend in Havana. This is a movie on American Movie Classics.
Okay.
This is a 1941 musical called Weekend in Havana. And again, TV Guide editorializing only gives it 2 stars, which is one star better than Eye of the Tiger. Yep. But it says, dated but nonetheless entertaining fable about a sales girl and her vacation cruise to a colorful Cuba that never was.
Weird. Yeah. Doesn't sound at all good. Gonna be honest, kind of just rolled the dice on that one.
Sounds weirdly anti-communist. Because, this is making Cuba look good? Yeah, it was never like that.
Right.
Weird, weird editorial.
That is a weird way to attack Cuba.
Yeah. I would, we got to say it or else these kids are going to watch this movie. They're going to become Cubans. I would have gone with Moonlighting. It's a repeat. This is an episode with Dr. Joyce Brothers and Ray Charles in this episode.
That sounds great. I'm sure I would have enjoyed that more.
Yeah.
Who was Moonlighting?
Bruce Willis and Cybill Shepherd.
That's what I thought. Yeah. I really liked that show. And I thought really Cybill Shepherd was...
She's stunning.
So hot.
She still is. She's one of the most beautiful women that's ever existed, in my opinion. And really funny. And such a great, weird character.
I mean, I would have totally watched that. At 9:30 on Tuesday, I would have watched Richard Lewis on HBO.
Yes. Okay. Did you enjoy his stand-up?
I mean, I just would really... I mean, that is what I would choose. Very I didn't neurotic. Then, but boy, that's what I would do.
Yeah. We could watch that now.
Yeah.
So Wednesday night, 8 o'clock, what are you going with?
Do you want to guess what I went with?
Yeah. You want me to guess? You think it's obvious or you think it's
I think odd? You'll be able to hazard a guess.
It's a little tough, actually.
Okay.
So I'm thinking it might be between Growing Pains and Highway to Heaven.
It's neither one of those.
Neither one of these.
Yeah.
Degrassi?
Yeah, because I would want to see young Drake.
He was on Degrassi, junior high?
Yeah.
I did not know that.
Is there more than one Degrassi?
There's several Degrassis.
Oh.
So there's the kids of Degrassi Street, which is what Degrassi started out as, which was a show about children who lived on the same street.
Okay.
Those same actors and kids were in Degrassi Junior High, then Degrassi High.
Oh.
In the early 2000s, they relaunched it as Degrassi, which was the children of the original things. I was going to say, how old is he?
He's too young.
Yeah, this was 1988.
He's like 26.
Oh, yeah, he was on Degrassi.
He was a child.
Yeah, he's on Degrassi, then the 2000s.
Ooh.
Yeah.
I didn't even think about it.
Yeah. But you just saw the word Degrassi.
Yeah.
This was a Canadian show
that
is it's all special episodes, but was sort of refreshing in that, and the revival wasn't like this, but the kids were certainly real kids in that they were kind of ugly or like had weird speech impediment. Like it was a show that stood out because you were like, these are real kids. And you would see other shows like Growing Pains, for example, they're all good looking kids.
Yeah.
And I love that show.
Yeah.
But Degrassi, you're like, why have they just shot a documentary about real children? And it wasn't. It was a scripted show, but it really stood out in a weird way. It is very weird. So Growing Pains, this is the conclusion of a two-parter. When Jason's vacation dreams are shattered, when Maggie gets a call home and Carol gets an unexpected visitor. So this one is when Maggie's dad dies and she has to go home to Medford, Mass.
What?
And he was a Medford cop on the show.
No way.
And you know, deal with that.
Oh.
Heartbreaking.
I like Growing Pains.
It's a great show.
Yeah.
Especially in 88. It was a really good series. It got bad later, but the first 3 seasons are good. So
what was its theme song?
The theme song went, why do I have family ties? And then Emmanuel Lewis. It goes, long as we got each other.
I'm right there.
Written by Stephen Dorff.
Oh, really?
Yes, not the actor Stephen Dorff. Musician Stephen Dorff. So, wow. 8:30, what are you going with?
Come on, Rodeo Finals.
Did you used to watch a lot of country rodeo stuff?
No,
or you just now
it sounds really
great?
Fun.
Yeah, it really does look exciting. Rodeo Finals look pretty good. I do want to mention that Head of the Class was on a show that I really enjoyed.
Okay.
Which made me want to be smart, and I'm not. But there was also the premiere... the cable premiere of the Madonna movie, Who's That Girl?
Oh, wow.
Which I had seen in the theater and oddly really liked.
Huh.
I think as a kid, I really loved Madonna, the actress. I had seen Desperately Seeking Susan. I went and saw Shanghai Surprise. Yeah, I don't know what that was about.
Man.
Didn't enjoy her music that much. Really enjoyed her
acting. I also have never enjoyed her music that much.
It's not great.
There's some songs that I understand that they're good, but
a lot of it's people derivative.
Go nuts about her.
They do. They really do. And there were better people in every genre she did.
I'm going to keep that in mind when I really like something and someone's like, yeah, it's not for me. And I'm like, whoa, yeah. What can't you understand? I'm going to be like, this is how I feel about Madonna.
This is your Madonna.
Yeah.
And then they'll be like, why are you getting religious? And then it'll get weird.
Yeah, I shouldn't have said that out. I'm just going to think that.
This is your Madonna. 9 o'clock, what are you going with?
I'm
going
to watch Batman.
So you're watching Batman. This is the 1966 Batman.
Oh, no. Why don't I read these more carefully?
Yeah. Well, it was before the movie came out.
What year did the movie come out?
89. Summer 89. It would have been the next time I saw it, my birthday. That summer.
Damn it.
Yeah.
Of course it wouldn't be on TV yet. That would take like 3 years before the technology. It did take
quite a while for them to... Because they would still do road shows of movies. So if they premiered on TV too early, they'd lose money.
What would I have watched? I don't know.
1966 Batman? You would not have...
I guess I would be fine. Who was it? Was Adam West,
yeah. Yeah.
Okay.
I would have gone with Hooperman, which was John Ritter's sort of dramedy show where he was a police negotiator. He would like talk people off of ledges. And he had a dog. It took place in San Francisco, was shot there. It's a really cool, weird, dark show.
Wow.
And in this episode, Hooperman is after the thief who's robbing stiffs in a mortuary in Susan's dead sure that her new novel will make a killing. Getting a little punny there for my taste, TV. Dead sure, killing.
But oof.
Would have watched it. And
have
then
you ever had a TV Guide writer, copywriter on the show?
I've tried to find who did it because there's theories, but no one's proven it. We assume they didn't watch all these shows and they were working from press releases from the studios. But we don't know how much they changed them. We don't know and who wrote those press releases. Do you know Marley Halpengrazer?
Yeah.
He used to, when he worked at Cartoon Network, he used to write basically the TV guidelines for the shows he worked on for the guides. So he was like, it's probably just some intern.
Wow.
That was as close as I got.
There is someone out there who knows the answer.
Someone knows. And every week I beg them to tell me.
Really?
Very few people who worked at TV Guide are willing to talk. It's a really anonymous monolith of a magazine.
Weird.
Yeah.
Is there any masthead information in the front?
Some things are. There was a few columnists that would get bylines, but for the most part, no.
You've hit them up on Twitter and stuff?
Yeah.
You've done your due diligence here?
I've tried, yeah. Nothing.
Interesting.
They ignored me. Completely ignored me.
Wow.
Yeah.
It's funny when I have a friend who's like trying to get pregnant and it's like, you know, they're having some troubles with it. And we were talking about it and he was telling me about like what's been going on. And I was like, have you gotten your sperm count checked?
Yeah.
And then as soon as I said it, I was like,
obviously.
Oh, way to go, Einstein.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But was he like, oh my God, I didn't think of that.
No, he made fun of me as I deserved.
You pulled the, you go and ask at a record store if they have a CD. Like, do you have the Naughty by Nature? And they're like, have you looked under N? you did that to him. Because he's like, yeah, I did. That's why I'm asking you. If you have it, it's not.
Kamau and I did this show in Atlanta and we drove by the venue and there's like no obvious place to park. And there's a huge line of people standing out front. And so I called and a guy answered, but it wasn't the guy. It was some menial dude. And I was like, hey, man, there's no place to park. And is there an artist entrance? And he was like, hang on. And he puts me on hold for 5 minutes. And then he comes back and he's like, I can't find anyone to ask. So I would just say pay to park in the parking garage and come in through the front door.
Yeah.
And I was like, dude.
Let me tell you the obvious thing.
I want to scream at you.
Yeah. Yeah, but sometimes the easiest answer is the answer.
I guess so. It turned out it wasn't the answer. There was another guy who was like, oh, you should have come in here, and I'm sorry, here's money for your parking. So that guy did not have information that was important.
For a second there, I was scared that you had gone back to the try and get pregnant story. Turns out there was another guy, and he was like, come in here.
Can read.
Boom! That's what I'm watching. Thursday. I think we're on Thursday.
Yeah.
Thursday night, 8 o'clock. I'm now 8 years old for 2 days.
Mm-hmm. Happy birthday.
Thank you, sir.
When's my birthday?
Your birthday is June only has 30 days, so it'll be Friday. It'll be the last day this week.
Okay, nice.
So 8 o'clock on Thursday.
Okay. This is going to be amazing, Ken. This is going to have a really spectacular ending, this episode.
Okay.
Okay. Thursday, I watch Top Secret, and I also watch Not Necessarily the News.
Okay, so Top Secret is a Zucker Brothers movie with Val Kilmer. Todd Barry's favorite movie of all time.
Really?
Yes, that's what
I love that movie.
It's a silly movie, but it was when Val Kilmer was the best movie wise ass.
He was amazing.
Yeah.
He could sing.
Really,
he was a good dancer, and he was a hilarious actor.
Had you ever seen any of the sort of Elvis movies that it was parodying? Because it's a spy movie, but it's really more of a parody of the Elvis.
No, but I got it.
You get it, yeah. You kind of get the trope of that.
Skeet Surfin' is the classic musical number that starts that off. And the backward scene, and the guy with the magnifying glass, the eye gag.
Yeah, the big guy, which is played by Peter Cushing, who was a big Hammer movie actor. Yeah, that is a really good movie, and I cannot fault you for watching it. I am watching Sledge Hammer, which is similar in tone, actually, to Top Secret. It's a very funny, silly, they call it a spoof of 40s detective movies, but it's not really. It's more of a spoof of like Dirty Harry 80s action.
Okay.
It's a really fun show. Only lasted 2 seasons, sadly. So I'm watching that. And you're watching Top Secret until 9 o'clock?
Yeah. The first hour? I was surprised at how much there was on that I didn't want to watch.
Yeah. Well, you didn't watch The Charmings at 8:30, which was a show I always watched.
I don't know what The Charmings is.
Charmings was about Snow White and Prince Charming who get enchanted and end up waking up in Burbank in 1988 and having to live a normal life.
Oh, my God. Yeah,
3-camera sitcom, The Charmings.
Fish.
Yeah.
Water.
Ain't here. Ain't no water for these fish.
God.
And then, obviously,
I will say, I think that's a funny, clever name for a TV show.
It is, and it was on 2 seasons.
The Charmings.
Yeah, The Charmings.
Her name was Snow White Charming.
Snow Charming, yeah.
Snow Charming?
Yeah.
Really? That was her character's name on the show?
Yeah, she got rid of the White.
Her middle name was White.
Yeah.
Snow White.
Snow, yeah.
In Burbank?
In Burbank.
We're basically in Burbank right now.
I could drive you to the house they use for the exteriors. Really? Of the Charmings. Yeah. I've driven by it.
You have?
Yeah.
Wow. I understand how deep it goes for
I drove
you.
By the Brady house the other day. It's not far from here.
Hmm.
Yeah, it's very weird. And then, of course, Cheers at 9 o'clock, which I had to watch.
Oh, okay.
Would you go with at 9 o'clock again? I'm sorry.
More Top Secret.
Oh, just Top Secret for the whole
night. Yeah, I just want to watch Top Secret.
And then 9:30, Night Court. One of my favorite shows.
Oh, yeah. I liked Night Court.
Great show.
Bull.
Harry. Funny. Harry. Yep. Harry Anderson, former magician and stand-up comedian.
Oh. I believe it. He's got that kind of energy, that presentation.
He was homeless for a while in New Orleans, where he's from. Started learning street magic. Really fascinating guy. Friday night, 8 o'clock. Final night of the week.
Okay. So I'm assuming that my mom didn't make me go to services.
Okay.
Which happened on Friday nights.
Yep.
Nope.
That's the sound of service on Friday night.
Yep. Okay, I have 3 things I'm doing at 8.
Would they be that late at night? So it's like 8 o'clock at night?
It would start at like maybe 7 or something like that. So you'd be getting home. How
long does a service go?
Friday nights are short.
Okay.
Maybe 45 minutes.
Okay.
So depending how far away we are, I might be home in time.
Okay.
But you might go to a dinner afterwards or like linger at the synagogue.
Right.
Talk to people.
Can you please name something? Linger at the synagogue?
The only Panic at the Disco.
Panic at the Disco is Linger at the Synagogue. It's like a Jewish dance funk band.
That's funny.
I used to dance at synagogues frequently. We had 2 places for dances in my middle school, and one was a church on one side of town, and the other was a synagogue on the other side of town.
And you'd go there for like a dance?
I'd go to the dances in middle school, yeah. I wouldn't talk to anyone, and I'd stand in the corner. Talk to the janitor.
Have you ever heard of the job you can have, bar mitzvah dancer?
No.
My friend Whitney was one. You would go to a bar mitzvah. You would be good at doing line dances, right. And
you get
would
just the party go started. And
get the party started. Dance with shy kids.
You know, that's innovative, and I am in no way shocked that it was created by the Jews.
You probably would only get it in towns with bigger Jewish populations. I didn't know about it until I got to Boston, like in Springfield, Missouri. Someone offered it to
you. Hey, you seem like a real party starter. Come here and do some dancing.
I think I met Whitney. She was a bar mitzvah dancer. Okay, so at 8 o'clock Friday, I'm watching.
Maybe I was going to make a horror joke.
Oh, yeah.
But I didn't. Yeah.
It's good.
Yeah,
it's good.
With the W, yeah.
I really like it. A horror. Yeah.
Yeah.
It's great.
Okay.
So in ascending order of how interested I would have been, on Friday I'm watching TV's Bloopers and Practical Jokes.
Love it. Absolutely love it. Watch it every week.
Mm-hmm. And it was like America's Funniest Home Videos, kind of, but just with TV?
Sort of. So bloopers from your favorite shows, they would show people following up and flub. And it was really fascinating because it was one of the first times you got to see like how the
BTS.
Things were made. Yeah, and people acting like normal people. They ran out of bloopers kind of eventually, so they started introducing the practical jokes, but they would be on celebrities, so it was like a proto-punked.
Oh.
And this particular one is Jennifer O'Neill and Meredith Baxter Burney from Family Ties are the victims of the practical jokes. Public service announcement bloopers from the NFL players Eric Dickerson and Dan Marino and Will Schreiner's trip around the world, plus newlywed game follow-ups, which did not include In the Butt. the famous newlywed blooper. Are you familiar with that?
No.
Did you know the newlywed game?
No.
So they would have a newlyweds on, yeah, and they would ask them, questions, and then they would have to match the questions like with the answers, and they would call sex whoopee. And one of the questions was, "Where is the craziest place your husband says you've ever made whoopee?" And she goes, "In the butt." And it was, for years, people thought it was just apocryphal, but I've seen the footage. It's real.
Oh my God, yeah, that's amazing.
It's a real answer.
That's amazing.
Yeah.
In the butt.
They want, like, in my car, or like, outside the beach. I know,
it's pure, it's perfect.
In the butt. So that was your number one.
That's my lowest.
Oh, lowest, okay. Yeah,
and then I'm also interested in Stephen King's Cat's Eye.
Which is a great anthology movie from 85.
I believe it. I've never seen it, but I think it would be
Drew
great.
Drew Barrymore. One of two Stephen King things she was in.
What's the other?
Firestarter.
I love Stephen King.
Did you read that a lot growing up?
I loved Stephen King growing up. Yeah. I read him a lot. And but much more than
Song.
But I don't
think of you as like a horror guy.
No, I loved Stephen King. Yeah. It was around a lot. And I played him in an epic rap battle.
Yes, I remember
years
that.
Later.
Which he's seen and enjoyed.
He saw and enjoyed. Yeah. Although he said that he thought that he lost, which I have to say, I don't... I am capable of saying the epic rap battles that I think that I lost. And that is one that I...
Did he contact him directly, or he just...
No, he tweeted about it, and I tweeted at him a few times, and then I was like, I'm going to be respectful. He's one of my... I love him.
I've peed next to him and served him.
Wow.
I've served him steak.
Wow.
Not the same time.
Hopefully not. There you go. Step ahead of me.
I watched The Cell with him.
But the thing that I'm most interested in, because it's so 1988 to me, is watching pro karate on TV.
Yes. Yes. This is in a pre-UFC world. And again, ESN, which was the sports network, was interesting. I'm not a sports person, but they would show crazy stuff like skateboarding and karate and Swimsuit 87.
Yep.
But this was, karate bouts taped in Tulsa, Oklahoma, and it was sort of very pure. And I would watch those all the time as well. Yeah.
It sounds super interesting.
Yeah. Did you ever do martial arts as a kid?
Yes.
Did you crop my guy?
I have a black belt in taekwondo.
Okay.
I mean...
The flashy martial art.
But quote, so like the boldest italicized underlined quotes around black belt.
Taekwondo is not a real self-defense martial art, but is more of a sport.
It means the way of hand and foot.
Yes, it does. It does. Like karate. Do you know what karate means?
No.
Empty hand. Because karaoke is empty orchestra. See?
Wow.
Learning Japanese with Ken Reed.
Cool.
9 o'clock we go with.
Ready?
Yes.
It's going to blow your mind.
Belvedere?
I didn't even... This was just the choice that I made. Just this is the way your podcast set it up for it to be. I didn't think about it. We hadn't had any conversations yet. I didn't have any intentions going in.
This is your birthday.
Do you know what I watched? On my birthday.
On your birthday. No, I'm...
Cobra the Snake God.
Of course.
Now do you believe ayahuasca is real?
Now I will do ayahuasca right now. Did you dose me in my burning tea? Cobra the Snake God on the Discovery Channel. This is a 60-minute documentary about the King Cobra. Wow. It is all tied up. It is all tied up. I do want to say, before I read you the cheers and jeers and we completely finish here, that 2020 was the one show I was not allowed to watch. I would have watched Mr. Belvedere and I'd Married Dora, by the way, from 9 to 10. It's the only show I wasn't allowed to watch. Here's what was on that night. A profile of Bill Denby, a 37-year-old Vietnam vet who had both legs amputated below the knee during the war. Today, he can walk and, as seen in his TV commercial, can play basketball with the aid of, quote, the Seattle Foot. A prosthetic device that allows people to, quote, have spring in their step again.
Amazing.
He's seen competing in something I didn't know was a thing, the National Amputee Games.
Wow.
Yeah,
cool.
I wonder if that's still a thing.
I just want to say one more time that we talked in this episode about snakes eating their tails.
Yes.
And I began and end with snakes. Documentaries.
Totally not by... And he randomly picked this TV guide. I did not look at it before. He did not look at it. And that's where we ended up. So to finish, I'll read you the cheers and jeers for this week. So TV Guide is opinionated. Cheers and jeers. It's a jeer-heavy week, so let's see if you agree or disagree.
You're right.
We start with the one and only cheer. To NBC's Today and ABC's Good Morning America for a refreshing change of pace. Last month, Today took us aboard the Orient Express. Good Morning America made a jaunt to Sweden. Whatever.
I don't care.
I'm indifferent. I don't care. Jeers to Nickelodeon's Double Dare for daring to push beyond the limits of good taste. Stand by as kids take pleasure in flipping pies into a partner's pants and sliding down a chute coated with chocolate.
I could not disagree more fervently.
I am 100%
sure. I cheer Nickelodeon for that. And I can't believe how like Protestant and like touchy these guys.
Children,
the boundaries of good taste.
He's sliding on a chocolate slide. Get used to it.
Do you think they thought it was too evocative of buttholes sliding down the chocolate slide? I don't think
so. It'd be funny if the next line was, "and all of the buttholes."
In the butt.
In the butt. Then we have jeers to those technicians and cameramen in stations around the country who are so misinformed and fearful about AIDS that they balk at covering the disease.
Good.
Yeah, that's a good jeer.
Good jeer.
What a weird combo. Like, hey, boo, Double Dare, for making jokes about pies and pants. Hey, boo to you for not for being afraid of AIDS.
Yeah, why don't give double jeers to the AIDS cameraman and leave Double Dare alone.
And finally, double jeers. Double jeers, double beers. To Barbara Walters for ludicrous daredevil escapades on her interview specials. On her May 11th show, she was zooming around on the back of a motorcycle clinging to Sly Stallone. She danced the mambo with Patrick Swayze. She helped the prow of a cigarette boat and went zipping through the Miami Harbor at high speed with Don Johnson. I think they're just jealous.
Who cares? Let her have some fun. Killjoys.
Let her have some fun.
God, liven up, TV guy.
It's not like she was on the back of the motorcycle trying to escape AIDS.
Yeah.
Well, Zach, thank you for doing
this. Thanks, Ken. This is really fun. Glad you did it. Oh, baby, I see you in my teeny set. Yeah, baby, I see
you in my teeny set. I cut your head off and put it in my... And there you go. That was Zach Sherwin, comedy rapper. Zach Sherwin, man, comedian, writer. Zach Sherwin. He does a lot of things on Epic Rap Battles. I think he played Stephen King, as he mentions there. You can check him out. I'll put links to all that stuff up on TVGuidanceCounselor.com, and you should buy his album as well. Buy two copies. Buy one for a friend. Buy one for, I don't know, just the summer, and listen to it with the top down, cruising the beaches, as I know you all do. As always, you can reach me at tvguidancecounselor@gmail.com or at canandicanread.com. You can find us on Facebook and on Twitter at TV Guidance. And please, if you got this through iTunes, if you like the show, please rate, review the show. It helps us greatly get up the iTunes charts, which sounds like an insult, get up the iTunes charts, and lets people hear about the show, which is very nice for me. So thanks again, and we'll see you next time on a brand new episode of TV Guidance Counselor.
But what I really like is getting high and watching nature documentaries. Okay. It's obviously just about big butts. Booch?
Booch.
How do you spell that? It's I would weird. Give up who I am and become a hunk.